upon structure graded fragment based dust discovery, tuberculosis, leprosy, and other microbial, mycobacterial infections. Sir, may I have the pleasure of your narration for today in the morning. What a nice morning to hear from you.
Thank you very much. Well, can everybody hear me? Yes. Well, thank you very, very much, Prakash, for a very kind introduction. I'd also like to thank Sam Raj for inviting and organizing my trip here. This is the first of three meetings this week in India. I've been coming to India for nearly 50 years, and it's one of the most wonderful places to come. So thank you very much for the invitation. The screen doesn't look very bright. I hope everybody can see it. I'm going to talk today about a very wide range of methods which we use in structural biology and drug discovery. And I'm going to focus on the recent work that we've done on mycobacterial infections. And that, of course, includes tuberculosis, cystic fibrosis, where Mycobacterium abscessus is an important infection, and also leprosy, where I've been introduced much more recently. But what I thought I would do to begin with is to just tell you about the main development that we've made over the last 20 years on drug discovery by telling you about my company. And my company works in cancer, and I'll tell you later how it was Bill Gates who came to my company and persuaded us to work on tuberculosis. So 20 years ago, I joined with one of my students of the 1980s. This is a very talented Haran Jyoti. He is working in companies. He worked in my laboratory in the 80s, but he's worked in Glaxo and in the company that we founded. I was absolutely delighted that he was elected to the Royal Society in the United Kingdom, and he's one of the first people in a company who's been elected. We've been trying to change the Royal Society to recognize the importance of innovation and translation in science. The other person who helped found the company was Chris Abel, and he's now the Pro Vice Chancellor of Cambridge University in charge of all science and research. And so these two and myself got together, and we proposed in 1999 that instead of using large molecules for drug discovery, we could begin by working on very small fragments. And the idea here is that if you have large drug-like compounds, you need a library of chemical compounds, which is something like 10 to the 40th. You know, companies use several million, and we're impressed. But several million is a tiny fraction of the chemical space of drug-like compounds. If you decrease the size, then you increase the promiscuity and you decrease the number of compounds. So for little molecules like this, I can use just 1,000 compounds, and I can use biophysical methods to define where they are. So that's the idea we had. And what I did is to go to another one of my students who's a venture capitalist. I taught him in the 1970s. He then joined Rothschilds and Abingworth, and he gave us a relatively small amount of money, £500,000, to try this idea out. He was very skeptical to begin with. So we put three people, two in my laboratory and one in Chris's lab. And Haran Jyoti was working in Glaxo. We were discussing on Saturdays and Sunday mornings about this proposal, and he then very, very boldly left his job in Glaxo and joined the company where we had absolutely no certainty of a future. And then we showed that the method worked. We could soak these very small fragments into crystals and we could see where they were. That was just a preliminary test. And then what happened is that we, over the next few years, built up. Haran became chief executive. We recruited around 80 employees, and this was a multidisciplinary activity. So what I did is I took the chemistry from Chris's lab and all the biophysical techniques of our lab. We worked in my lab for a year, but we then moved everything onto the Cambridge Science Park. So we have protein technology, structural biology, cheminformatics, medicinal chemistry, pharmacology, and we have some very good clinicians associated and employed by the company. So that's the background. I stayed in academia, where I was head of biological and preclinical sciences. So what happened is that we soon built a very large building. That's the sign that we have people and we have investment. And then we tried this technique. So the idea is that you take very small fragments, so less than 1,000, and you screen your drug target, in this case, a kinase, with these. And if I'm lucky, and I always get nervous at this point that one might not bind, but one usually does bind, and here you can see it bound. That's a tiny molecule, probably won't have any biological activity, but then you can sit and look at it and grow it to a larger molecule. And that we call chemical elaboration. We sometimes cross-link if we have two fragments. So this all went on in my company called Aztecs. We had the three founders, and we soon had, as you can see, 80 and then many more people there. It took us quite a long time to get drugs onto the market, but in 13 years, so quite a long time, you can see we had a lot of drugs in clinical trials. We also had a number of collaborations with large companies. And eventually, we decided that it was so expensive, we had to sell the company. And I didn't want to sell it to GlaxoWelcome or a Pfizer or an AstraZeneca, because they tend to asset strip small companies, and then you end up with all of your friends in the company without a job. And so what we did is we looked for companies that had a family idea of development and would look after us. And we were very lucky to find a company called Otsuka, and to our great delight, they offered us nearly $1 billion, $886 million for the activity. So it was worth waiting a little while. We had several drugs in phase three, and over the last few years, we began to move them into into use. So first, in November 2016, we got a milestone by USD FDA filing of a new drug, and that came out of our drug that we invented, but then we collaborated with Novartis because we needed to spend really hundreds of thousands to get it through clinical trials. That was a very nice event. And then in March 2017, we got our first drug approval through the company, and then we got it on the market. So it's been selling not yet $1 billion a year, but several hundred million dollars a year in the US and in Europe and elsewhere. We also have another one being fast-tracked through FDA, so we should have three drugs on the market in the next year or two. So that's the background, but it's all in cancer. But what happened was that Bill Gates then came to Aztecs and he said, can you work on tuberculosis in the company? And we said, we think we were going to have to sell the company. So we then took all of the ideas for the company and we spun it back again into our labs in the university. So it started in the university, it then went into the science park, and then the image of it went back into the university, because the problem is, of course, and this is a challenge we all need to discuss, it's very difficult to get companies to invest in phase two and phase three for infectious disease. So that's the recent history, but I'm afraid I want to tell you a little bit about the background. And so I'm going to tell you about the need for human and mycobacterial genomes to understand those and to be able to interpret them in terms of targets. And that means that we have to go through the genomes and describe the proteome in terms of structures and functions. And this is a very, very academic job. It's a very long-term job. I'll tell you a little bit about it. What we've done then is to take all of the targets that we have experimentally and then use computer methods to develop structures and information for others. And we put that in a database called Chopin for tuberculosis. Chopin because we thought that Chopin had died of tuberculosis. Actually, it's probably another mycobacterial infection. I maybe others of you here know more about recent discussion on that. But our database on tuberculosis is called Chopin. And then we have ligand interactions with the proteins in the database and drug candidates. And then, of course, the subject of the meeting is the emergence of resistance. And so far in this meeting, we've heard very little about actually how the mutations that develop in resistance actually affect the drug binding. And what I'm going to tell you is that it operates through many different mechanisms and not always by direct interference. I'm sure most people know that, but we've tried to do analysis and write software for it. And what we've been doing over the last 5 years is use machine learning methods to develop an understanding of mutations in resistance. So that's the background. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the history, because that to me has been very important. The most important person in that has been Dorothy Hodgkin. And Dorothy Hodgkin was, of course, a structural biologist, a crystallographer, she would have described herself. And we'd been working on insulin. But what happened to me was that because we needed to have insulin supplies, we had to go to companies. And we went to Novo, Wellcome, Eli Lilly, and I began to know lots of people in companies. And that was one of the most important aspects of working with Dorothy's lab. And people in Oxford, where I was at the time with Dorothy Hodgkin, so this was in the 1960s, so over 50 years ago, they used to say, why does Dorothy Hodgkin go to all these companies? And I used to tell the Oxford academics who sat in their high tables and had lovely meals and worked in their labs in isolation, that actually people in companies were really developing very novel things. And one of the things they did was to develop these crystals of insulin, which we use to solve the structure of insulin. But when I moved from Oxford, and now we're moving from the 1960s into the 70s and 80s, I thought that I would use this connection, and I started working on pepsin and renin. Renin's involved in blood pressure. And I then thought, well, why shouldn't I go and talk to industry and see whether they would help us? Now, academia was very critical. It took me several years to get the courage to publish a paper in Nature about how we could use structure in drug discovery. So this paper actually described things I've been doing for the previous 10 years. And what we were doing, of course, is taking the structures we've defined, in this case of renin, and we looked at the interactions of the ligand with the protein, lots of hydrogen bonds, but also pockets which are filled by the side chains. And the sequence here fits into these pockets. So this was a very good example to start developing the idea of structure-guided drug discovery. And this is what happened. So this was renin, and I was looking at renin for about a year before I realized that the two halves of renin look very similar. You probably can see it immediately. It took me a year. But then when I realized that, I realized there must be an ancestral protein that looks something like this. This is a dimer with two identical halves, whereas this started off as a dimer, the two halves fused, and then it diverged. But actually, the fold is the same. So I looked for this molecule. I wondered where it was. Was it around in nature now, or was it just an ancestral protein that had been lost? And to my surprise, a few years after I published a paper in 1978 predicting this, in 1984, I found it in HIV, as HIV sequence developed. And here's the HIV sequence. And you see there was an area labeled POL for polymerase and a few genes in it. But what we found later was that in the middle of this POL gene, there was a protease. And I looked at it and I realized it was what I'd been looking for. And so what I could do was to say we had a protease. It was very similar to renin. And so I went to Pfizer and I said to Pfizer, use your renin drugs and try them on HIV. They thought I was crazy, but it worked. And that was the start of getting involved in HIV, my first study in infection. And of course, what happens in HIV is you have an RNA which codes for a polyprotein. And the polyprotein is what I just showed you. And it has a number of genes all in one polypeptide chain. Now, that is then incorporated into the virus as it emerges. But of course, that immature virus will be inactive. And so the target protein needs to be cleaved. And that's why the protease is there. And the protease is only active when two chains come together. And so the proteolytic activity in HIV and many other viruses is completely controlled by the association of two polypeptides. And then, of course, this becomes active. We very soon modeled this protein. So this is the HIV protease. I was getting heavily criticized by experimentalists for doing too much speculation. So we did build models, One of my students, Lawrence Pearl at the time, published something on this, but eventually in 1989, we published in Nature the structure of HIV protease, and it was in parallel with a very good friend of mine, Alex Vladava, and the two of us published our papers in Nature about 2 weeks apart. And so then we were able to use this in drug discovery with and design molecules. But then I had another problem of a very different type, and I was introduced as having worked with Margaret Thatcher, our right-wing Tory prime minister. I was a left-wing Labour councillor in Oxford, but nevertheless I got recruited by Margaret Thatcher, and then she asked me to reorganize all British science and to change and move the research councils. And then I found that I couldn't have a company, and the company I formed in 1988 to work on HIV, I couldn't take it forward. So it was actually taken forward in other companies while I became, for a while, an administrator, I suppose. But of course, it led to drugs, and it led to resistance. So HIV, in many ways, is a model for what I've done since. I knew this was going to happen if I use this particular form. Let's try this one. I'm sorry about this. We had to change computers before I started, and I'm afraid this one doesn't operate very reliably. So what we decided was we had a model. We could go from the gene to the protein to the drug. And so what I've done, and this was, of course, around 1990. So what I started to do in my academic lab and, of course, in the company was to take this forward, not only on HIV, but on and renin, which I'd already been working on for 10 years, but on a number of different targets. So I want to tell you a little bit about it. Of course, it led to the formation of Aztecs, the company I described after a while. But it really involves two steps. First, defining biological space, and then defining chemical space. And I look at those as slightly separate, although, of course, they're totally integrated in the process. So first, what you have to do is to define your target. And I'm going to take a non-infectious disease example, which is non-homologous end joining, and show you what sort of things we have to do. That puts DNA strands together using a large kinase, DNA PK, and we then get the DNA repair. But the point that I want to make is that in order to study the structures and to understand how a drug will bind, we need a range of techniques. So we use small angle X-ray scattering. We use a lot of computer analysis. I'll tell you a little bit about that in a minute. We use X-ray analysis. This is a Nature paper we had in 2010. And it took me until 2017 to get a proper structure. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is that we need a range of different methods. X-rays are somewhat being taken over by cryo-EM, and here's our cryo-EM structure. I'll say a little bit about these, but I want to make it clear that to define a target in drug discovery, it can take you many years, even decades, and you need a large number of techniques. And that's my justification for doing computing methods, and I'll tell you about those. But what we've done is to take that structure, we've used very, very state-of-the-art methods using anomalous scattering, and this is the work of Lynn Savander and Dima Chagadze in my group that led to at the Science paper a year or so ago. We are also using cryo-EM, and I know India now has invested in that, but absolutely central to drug discovery and to structural biology is going to be cryo methods. You tend quite often to get low resolution structures if they're flexible molecules, but here is the cryo-EM. This took us 1 year to solve. This one took us more than 10 years to solve. So this is a very much faster method. And what we can do is we can look at complexes of the ligands. We can look at and collaborate with others. This is a Chinese work on a related project. And my approach has always been to try and collaborate with my competitors and to get nice structures. What we can do then is to look and see how they move, and some of them will move very large amounts, like this one on the right, when you add other molecules. So most biological systems are multi-protein systems with very complex dynamics. And then finally, you need to look at not only the structure, but what happens over time. And this is a way using single molecule analysis to look at this. You take a piece of DNA in this case, put it on this structure here. You have a ball which you connect DNA to, and then you let the molecules assemble and the reaction goes on. And you can follow one single molecule analysis over time. So we need structure and dynamics if we're going to understand these systems. So this is how we do it. Now, as I said, there's a problem, because this took 10 years, and a human genome is going to have 20,000 plus genes, but even tuberculosis is going to have 4,000 genes. And so we're usually in a position where we know the structure of around 10% of the genes, if we're lucky, and in some cases, many less. In tuberculosis, we're rather better than that now. But there's been huge investment in this. So how do we proceed where we have no experimental structure? So the answer is we develop computational methods, and that's what I've been doing in my spare time for the last 30-odd years. The first program we wrote was more than 30 years ago. It was called Composer, but the program that's used all over the world now, that was written by my student Andre Shani in my lab and published in 1993, is called Modeler. And Modeler, as I'm sure most of you know, can be used to take homologs, preferably orthologs, and take those structures and build new ones for your particular target. And so what we try to do is to use this to build models of the proteome of tuberculosis and other mycobacteria. And then we use Fugue, which is another piece of software, this time written by a Chinese student, Jie Shi, and a Japanese postdoc, Kenji Mizukuchi, in my lab, and that takes sequence and compares it using information about structure to get a good alignment, and you need that in order to build these models. So people used to criticize us and for doing too much software development and not doing enough experiment. I was actually doing a lot of experiment, and this is a program called Wrapper, written by a couple of young people in my group who were wrapping, a very exciting methodology. But the two methods that have really been used, you can see, are these two, Modeler and Fugue. And people who were criticizing us for doing software development when we should have been doing experiments, then 10,500 papers would have had to use another methodology, is my response. What we can then do is to use this software, and this is Bernardo from Mexico, who worked in my lab, to write Chopin, And we use that method to build models of all the proteomes. So, of course, if you're doing screening of drugs, you never know what the target is going to be. And what we do with these methods is we can build around two-thirds, around 67% of the proteins in the proteome, in other words, gene 70% of the gene products, pretty good models. Another section we can do probably 10 or more percent pretty well, and there's always around 10% of the genes where I can't get a very reliable model. But the outcome of this is that we can begin to make databases like Chopin in a completely automated way. And what we've done is the same thing for Mycobacterium abscessus, and that's absolutely become important in cystic fibrosis. I should say these are all people in my group, one Polish, one African from West Africa, one person from South America, Pedro from Brazil, and one person from Romania. My team is a little bit like that all the time, but what we've done is we've taken this very rapidly growing mycobacterium, and which causes these infections in patients with cystic fibrosis, and also is growing and giving huge resistance now to drugs, and we've modeled the proteome. In this case, we've been able to get models about 88%. So they're the good ones and the marginal ones, but the methodology which we've developed, again, over the last couple of years, particularly with Martin and Pedro, has been really transforming this area. We've also been working on leprosy, and this came when I was giving a keynote lecture in the American, or I think it was the International Mycobacterial Meeting, and the leprosy mission turned up, and this man is Sandeep Chaitana. He's from Vellore, or used to work in Vellore in India, and he is the person who's taken forward the international leprosy area of drug discovery, and that of course affects a lot of people, killing a lot of people each year, but it's much less advertised. We know it's in India, we know it's in Brazil, we know it's in certain countries in Africa, and I've got a map there of where the major places of leprosy are. And so we've also, in parallel then with the tuberculosis, been working on Mycobacterium abscessus and Mycobacterium leprae. And Sandeep is actually the director of drug discovery in the American Leprosy Mission, but he's based in my laboratory. So that's defining the biological space. What about the chemical space? So clearly what we're going to do here is to use the methods developed in our company to discover new molecules using the structural and biological function that we've developed in the first stage. So this again is, or should be, the, I think this is not going to work, which is why I wasn't going to use this one. We obviously have been looking at a large number of different areas, but neglected diseases in particular using the fragment-based methods. So in tuberculosis, as I said, what happened is that Bill Gates arrived at, well, he sent Ken Duncan, who used to work with Glaxo, but is working in Seattle, to our company, and he visited himself later and persuaded us to start working on tuberculosis. This is a slide I don't need to show this audience, really. But what we began to do more than 10 years ago is to start looking at targets. Now, this was rather welcome for me to be involved in this, because I'm very much involved in this part of Africa, and I'll show you why in a moment if you're not already aware. But Bill Gates was very passionately involved in trying to do something about tuberculosis, particularly in Africa, where it's been affecting a very large number of the population. And so this was his idea. And Bill Gates, although he's a charity, has been heavily involved in companies and got them all involved. But we spun it back from the company, as I said, into the lab. But why was it important to me? Well, this is why it's important. Here's my wife, Dr. Sibanda. She's quite a famous scientist, unfortunately just retired. But over the last 35 years, she's had a paper in Nature every 5 years, and lots of others in between. But she's still very much in Africa. These are my two daughters. This one's now a lawyer, and this one's a medical doctor. But here are my grand nephews, and they live in this beautiful country in Zimbabwe. And the problem there, of course, is that tuberculosis is widespread. So two of my very close relatives have had tuberculosis, and one of them had HIV, and we lost that person. And of course, that happened when they moved down into South Africa, where HIV and tuberculosis are very prevalent. So this is a family problem for me, as well as a scientific one. And of course, I've been aware of it for many years before I got involved. So what we did in response to Bill Gates was to look at the known drugs, the first line drugs for tuberculosis, and those for second line, and begin to think about them and choose various targets from there. So I then put together a very international research team. It's always had a good percentage of Indians in it. At the moment, Pooja Gupta has just come to from Delhi to join us. I think her father's quite well-known medical person here, but I must say she's one of the most incredible students I've ever had. Bridget is from West Africa. Vitor is leading it. And the particular project I'm going to tell you about was developed by Sachin Sarade in my lab, another Indian, but he's gone on to join a company now, so he's no longer in the lab. Vitor's from Portugal. So what we do is we take a fragment library, as I showed you that we do in Aztecs, and we use methods like thermal shift, that's the effect of the fragment to increase the stability, or we use things like surface plasma resonance to look at and screen very quickly. So within a couple of days of getting the target purified, doing a lot of biochemistry, we can do these biophysical experiments in a couple of days and screen about 800 or 900 fragments and get a start for the drug discovery. That's another picture from the SBR. So this is all set up, and everybody can do this in academic labs. And I should say, since we started doing it in academic labs, it's difficult to find a university anywhere in the world, China, India, Africa, South America, US, that aren't doing these sort of things. The first step then is to just do a screen of your fragment library using mainly biophysical methods. But then what we do is to try and characterize the molecules in terms of the rate of on and off of the fragment, the thermodynamics, and the structure using SBR, ITC, and X-ray, sometimes NMR. And what you get then is a whole series of fragments, if you're lucky. This is a repressor molecule, and you can see all the fragments, and it doesn't take too much of a chemist to be able to see you could join all these up and make a molecule that's going to bind rather tightly. Not every case is as easy as this. Sometimes you just get one or two fragments in one place and then you elaborate. So when we started, I got a phone call from Seattle, and the message came that Bill Gates wanted to come and spend the day with us, and he didn't want anybody in the university to know, because if he came to Cambridge and they all know, the vice chancellor and everyone else would take him, but he wanted to spend the day in the lab. So here he is. Somebody had already found that he was coming. I don't know how that happened. Here is Chris, my co-founder of Aztecs, and myself, and here is Bill Gates walking up the steps to my laboratory. And we made him put on a lab coat. I'm not sure whether he'd ever put on a lab coat before, but he did it and looks very smart. And then every person in my lab and Chris Abel's lab had to describe to him two things. First was their first discipline, and secondly was their first language. And then Bill would have lots of discussion. And at the end, we had a little group discussion, and this is Bill Gates asking a question. And here's my student. This student is from Portugal, and Bill Gates is asking him, he's looking at the screen, which is behind me here, and saying, well, I can see the drug, but where is the where are all the waters? You know, Bill Gates is very interested in water structure and has invested a lot in those areas. And my student was very quick. He said to, well, Mr. Gates, he said, I took out all the waters so you could see our beautiful drug. And so that was a very nice response. And Bill then further put in funding, and we were able to take a large number of molecules around this cycle of bioassays, cheminformatics, optimizing chemically, and get new molecules. These are some of the sort of things we do, and all the chemistry is done in Chris Abel's lab, and putting things together. Now, in parallel, what we've done is to think about understanding where molecules bind. We've developed ideas about hotspots taken those forward. And also, I won't go through this in too much detail, but if you go to our website and you want to find out where on your protein molecule you might find a binding site, you can go to this hotspot program. It really, in the computer, we run a simulation of a fragment screen because fragments hit hotspots. And it's a very good way of getting an initial feeling where to look for, and then you can begin to look at other aspects of cavities and other molecules. And what we're also doing is the same thing on Mycobacterium abscessus and doing drug discovery there. The major development recently in fragments has been made by Frank Blundell, who was a student in my lab 20 years ago, but has done it all independently. And this is a method called X-Chem, and it's done in the synchrotron and some very sophisticated software. So I'm just showing you these because if you're doing fragment screening in drug discovery, if any of you are, you need to be aware of these because it deals with partially occupied sites in a much more effective way. So this is what you find. You get lots of fragment binding sites, and you need to assess which are the ones you're going to take forward, and you need to look at cavities and other things like that. So this is on the Mycobacterial abscessus. Now, I think what's happened here is that I had a changeover of computers at the last minute, and I've got the wrong software in here. So I'm going to have to just stop and just go to the end of this where I want to talk on the mutation analysis, and then I'll finish. So all of this, of course, is, oh gosh, the program's now failed. Let me try again. Yeah. So all of this, of course, has been taking place while we've got the development of resistance. And the resistance mutations, of course, are common. So we were using them in cancer in a database called COSMIC. We look back often to the AIDS case where we first saw mutations and resistance. And we're, of course, very much focused on it in the mycobacterial studies. So what have we done over the last 5 or 6 years to try to understand the antimicrobial resistance? Well, we've developed a lot of software. The first software I did was 20 years ago, and this is a program called SDM. And what we do is we look at the thermodynamic cycle. So what you can imagine is if you have a mutation, mutation would affect the unfolded state, so the wild type and the mutant in the unfolded state, and it will also affect the wild type and the mutant in the folded state. And if you're going to understand the thermodynamics of it, you have to deal with that thermodynamic cycle. So what I did was to take that and then look at the statistics, and I'd written programs 30 years ago on the probability of mutations occurring in unfolded and in folded structures. And so putting the two together, what we got was this formula. I'm not going to derive it for you, but it's basically a use of this thermodynamic cycle and the statistical probabilities of each of these steps occurring. And from these, you can work out the free energy differences in the other parts. And the original persons who did this 20 years ago were key, but the two people who have been redoing the program and updating it recently, Catherine Wirth and another Indian, Aram Prasad, who's a very talented person I met when I was lecturing in Chennai about 12 years ago, I think. So that's the statistical method of 20 years ago. Then what happened is I got this guy in my lab who's a computer scientist, and this is the advantage of having a multidisciplinary lab. He walked in, I said, what you want to do, Douglas, I know you write programs, I've got this program, SDM, and I'd like you to rewrite it and do some improvement. He said, I don't want to do that. I said, well, what do you want to do? And of course, he was very much aware of machine learning. Even, well, it's now 6 years ago this happened. Machine learning's only been in the press relatively more recently. And so we came to a compromise that in the end, we would write a new program to look at mutations and resistance mutations in particular, but also in genetic disease. So Douglas did the work on the actual structure. So what we do is we describe the protein as a sort of series of graph-based signatures. It's quite simplistic, but then you have to have a database of information. So this is David Asher, who is visiting from Australia, and he set up a database of the impacts of mutations on the thermodynamics. And then you use machine learning to develop it. And I have to say, when this was developed first, I thought the program would never work. It was too simplistic. But machine learning is incredibly powerful, even when your descriptor of the protein is much less sophisticated. And so what we've been doing now is, and these are all totally available on our website if anybody wants to use them, you can go through and have a look. And I'm afraid I've got the wrong software, the wrong program here, but what we've been doing is applying them two mutations. And we have 5 or 6 flavors of these programs now, machine learning. So you can look at the impact, not just of a mutation on a ligand directly, but on a distant interaction, an allosteric interaction, or this case, you've got mutations at an interface, which is down the center here, and the ligands are over here. So you can have cases where you have mutations on interfaces. You can look at, we have special programs to look at protein nucleic acid interactions and protein ligand interactions. So these are all machine learning, all available freely, and you can use them. So just to end up, I guess the question really is, where do we go from here? And I've been thinking about that. The university says I'm 10 years past retirement, but I'm trying to plan for the next 10 years if I'm allowed to. And the question is, what should we do? And I think the real challenges now are to see whether we can use the sort of information we've got on the mutations, first to get better designs. As we design molecules, I can see some places we would go where mutations would more likely occur than others. But where it's already happened, where we've got resistance, then the sort of things that I've been thinking about certainly is repurposing, and I think this is very much the most realistic aspect of dealing with resistance. But also, you can do quite a lot by taking a molecule and then reversing the chemistry a little to avoid where the mutation occurs and then regrowing it. And then another area we've been working on, and I've not had time to talk about it, is interfacial stabilizers. So where you get a mutation that destabilizes a complex, you can sometimes stabilize a complex by having other molecules, drug molecules, which actually stabilize it in interfaces. So they're my general messages. I'm afraid the bit on resistance is a little shorter than I hoped. But this is what you need. These are people who have been in the lab over the last 2 years, so they're not all there at the time. One of the problems with my lab is that people getting good jobs. So this lady, Chan Wu, and another one, Takash Ochi, who's left a little while ago, have just got lectureships in Leeds University, where there were, I think, 200 or 300 applicants, and they got the job, both of them, and their partners. And then there are people like David Asher, I was describing. He's in Melbourne as a professor, and Douglas Pierce has got a professorship also in Australia now. But you see, the other thing that I'm proud about, because this is the inspiration from Dorothy Hodgkin and J.D. Bernal, is that the group is international, interdisciplinary, and it's gender balanced. And I've been spending a lot of time over the last 30 years trying to make sure that more women are able to progress their careers to a later stage. And I think it's a challenge we all have in our labs. And I'd just like to end by giving credit to my wife, who managed to produce children and worked to the day before she gave birth in each case, and continued to publish at a high level for that very long time. So you need lots of friends and partners, as well as good scientists. And so that's my story. It's a rather rambling story, but I hope you can see that we are trying to do something about resistance. We're certainly working in microbacterial infections, and I hope that the methodology that we've been using will be generally helpful. I'm sorry about changing the presentation. It still says Faridabad here, but thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sir Tom Blundell. It was very inspiring, thought-provoking, and a hilarious lecture for most of the young scientists and also workers working in your field. I do remember we had visited your place, and it's a consortium of knowledge center, let me tell you. You, as you mentioned in one of your slides, you have around 38 nation nationals there working together. And many a time you also mentioned to us during our visit that time that they had a different cuisine, they had different culture, but they were working on a common target. And you are the one, as a crystallographer, made them to work from different angles, but to gel with a protein that can be used as a drug or a new approach that can really see that how best we can combat the resistant microbes. What a wonderful lecture, Dr. Tom Blundell. We are really indeed honored by your lecture and your presence, and I hope that day is not far off with your rich experience and academic credits and credentials that you have through the scientific work that you have endeavored over a period of time. You would also join Dorothy Hoggin, be blessed with the Nobel Prize. May God bless you, sir. The forum is open for queries if you have.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, you're making me work further, are you?
Thank you so much. It was a really inspiring talk. I am Dr. Ramendra, working here in Department of Biotechnology. My question is, what should be the criteria of selecting repurposing drug against the tuberculosis?
Sorry, I'm a little bit deaf. What criteria, can you say again?
What should be criteria of selecting repurposing drug against treatment of tuberculosis?
Actually, what the question is, what are the criteria to select drug for repurposing against tuberculosis? Repurposing.
Oh, repurposing.
I yeah.
See. Yes, that's the word I missed. I would do an analysis, obviously, of the target. And I mean, a lot of the criteria for drug will already be there because they're not all target related. So you can assume that it's going to get access to the target, although it's going to be much more difficult with tuberculosis or some of the other mycobacteria. But I would just want to make sure that I understood the target in terms of the structure and binding, and I don't think I would be too prejudiced up front about criteria. I just do some screens. I'm sorry, it's not a very helpful answer, but I think you could more or less, you could obviously do computational work to begin with, like we could do a virtual screen and docking and so on, but I would do the experiments.
Thank you very much, sir. And continuation of this question, what about in case of co-infection? Co-infection.
Patient.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, well, that's a problem. But I think what we can do is we can sort of morally blackmail companies to the idea that they might do something useful for developing countries in particular. And but that's going to be a challenge generally. But I would certainly think that there are many people in large pharma who have a conscience that they're mainly making drugs for the developed world, and most of the infectious diseases are in developing countries. And I think we're going to get quite a lot of collaboration from them. So but patents are going to be a problem. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir.
I'd like to ask a few. Just for a clarification, is that when you identify a small molecule through in silico or some other source as a docking molecule, as a drug? And how will you rule out if it is not affecting the other natural molecules or functional molecules which can affect the other processes? How will you rule out?
Yeah. Are you asking me? So the fragment we get at the beginning is going to be promiscuous.
Yeah.
So then what we do is...
Sir is asking, the molecule that you are identifying through computational approach, do they have off-target effects?
A computational approach. Well, we use computational approaches to try and find off-target effects. What happened is I had to change computers just before I started, and you can see the section I had about selection of targets and off-target effects it was missing. This was not the presentation I was going to give. But we have around a 10-step set of criteria for target selection. And what we've done is we have models of the human proteome and models of the bacterial proteome, and we can do very fast computational scans to see whether there are any likely off-target criteria. It's not very, very secure, but it's the best we can do at the moment. But certainly we look, when we're designing a molecule, always we look at the human ortholog, and we spent a lot of time looking at the microbiome, but I found if you actually look at all the possible targets in the microbiome, you'll end up with no target at all. So you have to accept that you're going to hit some off targets in the microbiome, I think. But we do our best. But what I missed saying was we have all the procedures of essentiality that we would normally take. So we've been working a lot on that, because we've started quite a lot of programs in the early days and found later that we hadn't met these criteria and the programs are not useful. And I think that's where academia is weakest.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And while getting elored with this lecture here, I forgot to mention most important credential Sir Tom Blundell has. He and his brother both are having knighthood. He got the knighthood in the year 1998, and his brother for the economics. And between the two knights, he used to always say, my sister keeps asking me, you are two knights, where am I to go? Then he said to her, you are the day, okay? So the family is of knighthoods, and I'm sure his endeavors will culminate success for one who are fighting against leprosy, tuberculosis, and the other disciplines in which he has worked enormously with his crystallographic work, and also the contributions he made for various foundations as advisor to the UK government or Bill Gates Foundation. Thanks a lot, sir. We are really inspired by your work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor Tom Blundell, for his interesting and inquisitive talk. And I also want to thank Dr. P. Prakash for chairing this session. May I request the audience to please proceed for the tea, and we'll be back at 11 o'clock sharp. And may I also request the poster participants from N to Z alphabets to dis-